with the Qur'an, and some aspects of it that are not so often talked about. I'd like to begin from a very basic point of view, that the Qur'an isn't just a religious text for the Muslim. The Qur'an is actually a document that illustrates the worldview of a Muslim. Now, what does it mean to have a worldview? It basically means the way you look at life, the way you look at everything outside, the way you look at yourself, the way you look at your own goals, your career, your family, right? The way you observe things outside and pass judgments on them. All of that has been reconfigured by this book. And the Muslim is supposed to have a relationship with this book that isn't just intellectual, isn't just spiritual, it's also kind of psychological. The believer starts thinking through the Quran. I share this with my students all the time, that the Quran has its own logic. It has its own way of presenting ideas. It doesn't just give you a conclusion. It introduces a conclusion by means of certain things Allah calls attention to, and then He gives you a conclusion. For example, we were listening in Salah. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, He takes an oath, إِنَّهُ لَقُرْآنُ كَرِيمٌ, right? فِي كِتَابٍ مَكْنُونَ. But He doesn't just say that. He says, فَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِمَوْهَاقِعِ النُّجُومِ وَإِنَّهُ لَقَسَمٌ لَوْ تَعْلَمٌ عَظِيمٌ. He starts by talking about stars. The subject is the Qur'an, but He doesn't start by talking about the Qur'an. What does He talk about first? The stars. And this is actually a kind of logic in the Qur'an. It's a way of thinking. And Muslims, unfortunately, nowadays, we look at the Qur'an as a source of references, meaning, is this thing halal or haram? Or what is the evidence for this fatwa? Where can I find the ayah for that? But we don't go to the Qur'an as the source of thought itself. How does the Qur'an want us to think? How does the Qur'an want us to actually process things when we come into contact with it? As I was driving here, it was a very silent ride. Because a couple of the guys were asleep, it was late, I know, but that's okay. It was good, it gave me a chance to think. So we're driving here, and you know it's highway, and there's open fields, probably something beautiful in California, we don't see that in New York, or in Maryland, or anywhere else, right? Open field, and then mountains in the far distance, right? And I'm looking at this and I say, SubhanAllah, Allah does not let us escape the thought of the Qur'an if we immerse ourselves into the Qur'an, and the Qur'an enters into our bloodstream, literally. And you're driving and you see those mountains, and you say, وَإِذَا الْجِبَالُ سُيِّرَتْ. When the mountains are just going to sail away. And as fixtures as they are, you know, I was just talking to some of you guys, and you know, you're saying, I'm baffled by the mountains when I come here in California. It's just so beautiful. And you guys, we don't even realize it's there, we kind of just, you know, because it's part of life. But you never think of them as sailing away. So now the next time when someone's memorized even a little bit of Qur'an, when they see the mountain, what are they trying to visualize? Them sailing away, SubhanAllah, like clouds sail away. You look up into the sky, you see clouds. وَالسَّحَارُ الْمُسَخَّرِ بَيْنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضَ آيَاتٍ لِيُقَوْمٍ يَعْقِلُونَ. There are remarkable, miraculous signs in the clouds that are stuck between the heavens and the earth. You look at the sun, and it's about to set, and you say, فَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِالشَّفَقِ وَاللَّيْلِ وَمَا وَسَقَ. Allah takes an oath by the redness of the sky, that mother time's coming. And the sun is not turning from, it's turning from yellow to red, and the sky is turning red. And the night is about to settle in. Allah calls our attention to it. And what is it a reminder of according to the Qur'an? What logic, what thought comes to mind when you think of that? The thought that comes to mind is the thought of نَفَقْبًا عَنْ ظَلُمْ. You're going to ride one stage after the next. You can't help it. You are on this journey. And just like when you see the sky turning red, night is inevitable. Just like that, your journey towards Allah, every step is inevitable. You can't take a step back. No matter how hard you try, you can only take a step forward. You get stuck in traffic, all these people driving on this journey now. SubhanAllah, ya ayyuhal insan, innaka kadhibun ila rabbika kadhibun mulaqi. You human being, you forgetful human being. Insan really doesn't just mean human being, it comes from nasiya, the one who forgets, right? Allah calls the one who forgets and He tells him, you are marching forward towards your Lord. You make all these efforts in this direction and that direction, you're working towards your studies, towards your job, towards your family, towards saves, whatever you're working towards. The reality is, you think you're working towards those things, the only thing you're really making progress towards is meeting your Lord, فَمُلَاقِهِ. Then you're going to get to meet Him, SubhanAllah. Or on this journey. So even looking at a road reminds you of that. I looked to the right, I saw some cows. Literally, some pasture. And you know what I noticed about the cows? I mean, cows are moving at fast speeds, but they don't even look up to see. You know, if there are other wild animals, at the very least, what do? They look, it calls their attention, but they're proud, they're chilling, they're on their own. don't care what's going on around them. And this is exactly the kind of heedlessness Allah compares the heedless person to. Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ كَمْ أَنْعَامٍ بَلْ هُمْ أَضَلُّ. They are like cattle, they're even worse off. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْغَافِلُونَ. Those are the heedless. They lose sight of the world around them. They're just lost in their own entertainment. They're lost in their own world. Right? SubhanAllah. The end. Okay, last one. So we're driving, and you know, I see this big billboard for a real estate agency, and they've got a beautiful picture of a home, right? And there's a family happy outside, and they're, you know, hugging each other or something. You see those kinds of billboards, right? Because that's the American dream, right? That's the thing. And then of course, when you're on the highway, you see a nice car pass by and catches your eye. Whoa, yeah, that's nice. They did a nice alternation to the back lights and whatever. Or they change the shape a little better now, right? So you see the house, and Allah says, وَمَسَاكِنُ. The homes you love, you're so pleased with them. They're just in the neighborhood you wanted. They're just the exterior you wanted. They're just the interior design. The carpet matches the curtains, whatever it was. It's just the way you like it. He says, أَحَبَّ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَجِهَادٍ فِي سَبِيلِهِ. This home you beautify is better, is more beloved to you than Allah's messenger is struggling in their path. It puts things in perspective. You can't even look at a home anymore and smile. Allah puts things in perspective. You look at that family, the guy comes home to his family and he's happy, right? Allah says, إِنَّهُ كَانَ فِي أَهْلِهِ مَسْرُورًا. Right? He used to be happy with his family. He used to come back to his family very happy. وَيَنْطَلِمُ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ مَسْرُورًا. For the believer on the day of judgment, he will go to his family happy on the resurrection day. That's when he's going to find happiness. In other words, what I'm trying to say is, you can't go outside and not experience the ayat of Qur'an. That's the nature of Qur'an. It's not something caged in a book. When you become a student of the Qur'an, it starts taking over everything you. You look outside the book, you see Qur'an. You look inside the book, you see Qur'an. You can't escape. And this is really, it's part of the very critical part of the worldview of the life of a Muslim. It shapes the way the Muslim thinks. Everything reminds him of Allah. And one more came to mind, I should share it with you. So we're driving and there's this nursing home at an old lady smiling in the nurse next to her. Whoever we give old age, we start reversing them in creation. You know, Allah does not let us escape the thought process from this book. Now here what I want to share with you are some basics that, you know, from perhaps a little bit of a different point of view, but something inshallah that will help you, you know, give you traction and momentum in your relationship with the Quran. Many of you are familiar with the concept of fitrah, right? Nature. Predisposed nature that Allah created us on, human beings. Fitrat Allah and then fitrat nas alayh, right? This is the predisposed nature of Allah, the design of Allah, literally carving. Fitrat means to carve. Allah carved us a certain way. And this is something predisposed from Allah. Allah speaks about in Surah Al-A'la, He says, الَّذِي قَدَّرَ فَهَدَى. The one who created in precise measure and then guided it. What does that mean? That means Allah created, for example, the soil in precise measure. He created the seed in precise measure. He created the water in precise measure. And the seed knows how to grow and where to come out. And the earth knows to leave way and make crack open. So it makes way for the plant to come up. The baby knows that it has to cry for its lungs to fill with air. And the mother knows, her body knows that her chest should fill up with milk because the baby is going to drink. And the baby doesn't have to take a course on how to drink milk. It knows already. Allah created it and He guided it. The child knows. The bee knows where to go, which flower to go, and what to suck from it, and how to build its nest. How to build, you know, how to create honey. And the human being knows how to draw it from there. SubhanAllah, Allah guided. Allah guided the human being. Allah guided the bird where to find its nest, and how to bring it back and take these twigs and make a nest. Even if it's somebody's, you know, nowadays birds build their nest inside like the vents of your air conditioning or whatever, and it seems like it's unnatural. That's nature. Our homes are unnatural. But that's nature. That's Allah's design. SubhanAllah. And it's supposedly interfering with our design. We live in funny times, right? When you, and this is really man versus nature is part of this discussion. You know, I used to go to college in New York City, and I used to work there too. So you go in the subway, of course, you're just surrounded by concrete and metal and technology, right? And everybody, a bunch of zombies sitting in the train, and we get off after 45 minutes, and we're all walking to our work. Nobody looks up at the sky, nobody sees a single bird. Right? And even if they do, they're covered in dirt because there's polluted pigeons, poor creatures, right? And then every few like steps, there's like a tree. Like they put a decorative tree. But you know what happens? Sometimes the grass, starts coming out of the pavement. Like weeds start, and it looks unnatural. But you know what's the funny thing? What the funny thing is? That's the only thing natural.
Everything else is unimaginable.
But that's how the world has become to us, right? We look at undeveloped land. We call it undeveloped land, right? But it's really, what is that? That's land in its pure beauty. We're the ones who violated the rights of this earth, subhanAllah, right? So the idea of fitra, the human beings were predisposed with a certain innate nature. Like all creatures. All creatures have a nature. The cow knows not to eat, not to go after things that it's not supposed to eat. It eats grass, it knows. It knows. Allah put it in its nature. And there's as part of this nature, Allah Azza wa Jalla, He didn't just create us out of one thing, He created us out of two components. One component is our body. The other component is what? The ruh. Right? Two components. Now one of these components, when Allah talks about it in the Quran, He actually humiliates it. Allah says, أَأَنْتُمْ أَشَدُّ خَلْقًا أَمِ السَّمَاءُ. Right? Are you a tougher creation than the sky? بَنَاهَا. He created the sky. How pathetic are you compared to the sky? Then He says, قُتِلَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا أَكْفَرَ. May the human being be killed, this forgetful human being, he should be destroyed. How horrible, how obnoxious is disbelief. مِنْ أَيِّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقَ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ. What did He create him from? From literally sperm. From a dirty fluid that people wash off of their clothes. Something humiliating, that's where He began. Right? خُلِقَ مِنْ مَاءٍ دَافِقٍ. He came out of a water that gushes up, a fluid that gushes up. A humiliating beginning for the human being. So when Allah speaks about the physical human being, He reminds us of our humble beginnings. But when He speaks about the ruh being blown into Adam alayhi salam, and then into the children of Adam alayhi salam, He says, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. We honored the son of Adam. Same human being, right? On the one hand, Allah is humiliating the origins of this human being. On the other hand, He's honoring them. SubhanAllah, the same human being. So in it is something that will bring us honor, and in us is something that will bring us what? Humiliation. Both of them are entitlements. Both of those things are there. So فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُوَهَا وَأَقْوَهَا. We heard that even today. Both things are inside. Now Allah Azza wa Jalla created this nature inside of us. And we know the urges of our body. Hunger, shelter, to provide a roof over your head, to put clothes on your body, to dress according to the weather, climate, to clean yourself. These are needs of your body, desires towards the opposite gender. These are needs of your body. You don't have to be taught them, you feel them. Allah has predisposed them. زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِكُمْ وَالشَّهَوَاتِ وَالنِّسَاءِ وَالْبَنِينَ وَالْقَنَاطِيرِ الْمُقَنطَرَةِ. There are some things we're pre-programmed with to love. We love some things. We don't have to be taught to love them, we just love them. A child is not taught to love to play. Right? They're not taught to love to play, they just play. It's natural to them. It's natural to them. A teenager is not taught to be concerned with their appearance. They become obsessed with their looks. Naturally. وَزِينَةً. Right? A young man or a young woman is not taught to become full of themselves, or to show their accomplishments, or to show people their diploma, or what college they go to, or what GPA they got, or whatever else. They're not taught to do that. It just comes. It's just part of being a human. But on the other hand, Allah blew into this human being a ruh. And this ruh is from the amr of Allah. Shahulir al-Nahimi, a remarkable scholar, talked about the different kinds of creations of Allah. And he made a distinction between tadbirullah, and then the khalqullah, and amrullah, awamirullah, right? And in the world of amr, the ruh is from the amr of Allah. But the tadbir is like, you know, Allah plans, for example, He creates the seed, and it's part of Allah's planning that seed will turn into a tree. It takes time. It takes time. So it's into the world of time and space. But the amr of Allah is timeless. It's something that was all of our arwah, all of our souls were created when? All at the same time. This is in Surah Al-A'raf itself, right? أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ. Am I not your Lord, all of you? Kum is plural. All of us were created at the same time. Because that's from the amr of Allah. You know what else is the amr of Allah? The book of Allah is the amr of Allah. The angels come with the amr of Allah. Right? So, بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ أَمْرٍ. Right? They come down by the permission of the Lord from all kinds of umur of Allah. This is the amr of Allah. Now the thing is, our body, Allah created it. Allah says, خَلَقَهُ مِنْ تُرَابٍ. He created it from dust. From that fluid, all of these things are worldly, right? Earthly things. So all of the needs of the body are where? On the earth. The food of it comes from the earth, the clothing of it comes from the earth, the shelter of it comes from the earth. But the ruh that Allah gave, did the ruh come from the earth? Did Allah create this? Is this a worldly thing or something from the heavens? So the heavens, the angel delivers it into the womb of the mother, isn't it?
So when the body gets hungry, its food comes from the earth, because the body is from the earth. But when the ruh gets hungry, where can it get its food? It has to come from where it came from. And that is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah gives the example of the ruh, or the fitrah of the human being, as light. Another way of looking at it is light. And light that is inside the heart of every person. Every person is born with it. Kullu mawludin yuladu ala al-fitra, as we find in the hadith of the fitra, right? That's recorded in Al-Ma'in al-Nawawi also. So that every human being has this light inside of them. They're predisposed to know Allah. I'll tell you something interesting. There are many aspects to the fitra, but something on the side that you should know about fitra. I used to be in this social psychology course. Take a social psychology course if you get a chance. It's very interesting. It gives you a good perspective on human fitra. Social psychology is mostly a study of how people interact with each other. You know? And we were in the chapter of lying. Of course, this is at my college, and non-Muslim professor, non-Muslim students, everybody's non-Muslim. And we're studying the chapter on lying. And they make a distinction between professional liars, like criminals and actors and politicians, etc. Professional liars, as opposed to first-time liars. People that don't really lie for a living, but they're put in a situation where they have to lie. And the guy who's a first-time liar, you know what happens to him? The pitch of his voice goes up, right? His blood pressure increases, the hair on his skin rises. When he's put in a position where he has to lie, there are some physiological effects. He starts sweating, right? He feels like a thumping. Now, all of these things, I stopped my professor, I said, well, lying isn't like a pill you take or some physical thing. It's a psychological thing, right? It's in your head. So why are all these physiological things happening? Like the blood pressure increasing and the hair on the skin rising and the sweat pouring. These are physiological things. Sweat pours when you're hot, right? Nothing physical happened to him. He's just blind. Why are these physical things happening to him? You understand how something abstract is causing something physical to happen? So now, you know what my professor's answer was? That my non-Muslim, agnostic, non-religious professor's answer was this. He said, from what I can tell, the human being was not programmed to lie. That's what his answer was. In other words, he confirmed the existence of what? The fitra. Allah created this fitra on truth. It is not, disturbed by falsehood. It's disturbed by falsehood. And when the ruh is disturbed, its manifestations come even on the bodies. But then you can become immune to that, eventually you can get rid of it, and then your body feels nothing. You feel numb, you feel no remorse. So this is a little bit about the fitra. Now I want to tell you some things about how Allah challenges this fitra. I want you to think of our concerns in life in three levels, three layers of concern in life. There's a kind of person who's only concerned about themselves. How am I going to pay the bills? Where am I going to get the job? When am I going to graduate? Who am I going to get married to? Right? How am I going to pay off the house? Which car am I going to get? What about my savings? Etc., etc., etc. Just themselves. Maybe at the most themselves and their family. That's their only concern in life. And there are a lot of good people like that. That their only real concern is themselves and their family, their children, their parents, etc. Then there are people who take a step a little further. They're not only concerned about themselves, they're concerned about the rights of others. These people, Muslims or non-Muslims, they become activists. Maybe they become animal rights activists, right? Maybe they become civil rights activists, right? They become all kinds of activists, and it's not even that their rights are being violated, they're more concerned with this idea of other people's rights being violated, right? Sometimes it's for themselves, but they say, no, it's for generations to come, we're gonna fight for their rights, right? Or it's for the planet Earth, or whatever it is. But it's beyond themselves. They're concerned with something beyond themselves. And of course, we consider these people at a higher level than the people who are only concerned with themselves. Right? This is at a little bit of a higher level. But then there's even a higher level of thought. So this is the first level is for yourself. The second is for justice, just generally the concept of justice. And then there's a third level. And this third level is a person who thinks even above this and says, why have all of us been put here? What am I doing here? Where are all of us headed? I mean, there's so much injustice on this earth, there are so many things inside of me I feel a void of. There's something empty, there's something hungry inside me, that ruh is hungry. Where do I feed it? I can't fill that void. I try filling it with music, I try filling it with clubbing, I try filling it with drugs and with alcohol. Nothing filled it. I'm trying to figure out what can fill this void. And maybe then, if I can find how to fill that void, maybe my personal concerns and the concern for justice, all of them will be solved. If we can just figure out that the ultimate truth, the higher truth, Most people don't think like that. Most people stay at the first two levels of thought. Either they're concerned about themselves, or they're concerned about some contemporary issue, but they're not concerned about truth itself. Right? What is the ultimate truth? What is my purpose in life? These are not the concerns. The Qur'an, subhanAllah, addresses people at all of these levels. It addresses people at all of these levels. It comes to the one who's only concerned about himself. And you know the one who's concerned about himself, when he buys something, he wants to make sure that he gets the full amount that he paid for it. Right? He gets the full amount. But when he goes to work, right, and he gets paid from 9 to 5, if he leaves at 4:50, he doesn't feel so bad. He doesn't feel so bad because, you know, I mean, come on, take it easy. But if he was buying something from someone, if he hired somebody, and the guy was leaving 10 minutes early, what would he say? Hey, I'm paying you for 10 more minutes, you stay here for 10 more minutes. You follow? Allah says, وَيْلُمْ مُطَفِّفِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا كَانُوا عَلَى النَّاسِ يَسْتَغْفُونَ وَإِذَا كَانُوا عَلَى النَّاسِ يَسْتَغْفُونَ. Well, ultimate destruction of these people who slice off a little off the top. Tatfif al-Mizan is not cheating big millions of dollars in business. It's just slice a little off the top. Take a little bit off. So the guys, you know, there's a scale of 2 pounds, and there's rice of 2 pounds, the guy will take a handful and put it back. Because you can't really tell that much difference. It's like 0.1% I kept back from my merchandise, right? So just a little bit of cheating, not too much. I left work a little early. I took a little extra lunch break without my boss, so not too much. Just a little. This is the one who's self-centered. Allah even talks to him and says, no, aren't you? When it comes to gathering from people, you want everything. But when it comes to giving, you want to give a little less. So what is Allah calling this person to? When you feel like you're entitled to something, that is in and of itself, it's a proof that you have in you a pre-programmed respect for justice, because you want justice for yourself. So if you want justice for yourself, naturally you should want justice for others. So it's taking people at that lower level, and what is it doing? It's bringing them at a higher level. They should be concerned with justice, and it takes them to a step even above that. If you're concerned with justice over others, don't you realize that the one who made you aware of this justice, who programmed you with this sense of justice, don't you think he'll be coming after you? How just were you? Were you fair at all? It brings you to that higher purpose in life. But it starts at that lowest level. Then it goes to the people who are committing evils in the society. Allah says, بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. When the baby girl, the one who was buried alive, was asked, what crime was she killed for? This is very important. بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. The word سُئِلَتْ is really important. She was asked. You know why that's important? Because nobody used to ask. The guy kills his daughter and people say, what? It's their business, whatever. No, who's going to come for her? You know you have an attorney, you have a lawyer, you have the state, you have the government, you have somebody fighting for your rights. If you don't have somebody, you hire someone to fight for your rights. Who does this baby girl have that used to get buried alive? Who does she have? No one. Nobody here. Nobody's there to fight for her rights because these people said it's not our business. Let's just deal with our situation. Let me not deal with her. Allah says, no, I'm going to appoint her an attorney on the day of judgment. A trial, and she will be asked, what crime were you killed for? Could you tell me what happened to you? SubhanAllah. And you know what's amazing about that surah and takbir? In the beginning, Allah mentions another pregnancy. This is, of course, a pregnancy of a baby girl being born and being buried alive. Allah says, وَإِذَا عِشَارُ عُقِلَتْ. That's also a pregnancy. That's the pregnancy of the she-camel that delivers. You know, when the camel was 10 months pregnant, this was the most expensive asset of the Arab. Because when the camel's about to give birth, his money, his wealth is about to double. His money's about to double, because that's his asset, right? So this was a really expensive asset. And they would never lose sight of it. And they would take extra care of it, feed it extra. It was a sign of nobility. When somebody would come over to your house and see a fat she camel that's pregnant, they'd say, congratulations. Yeah, thanks. It's like opening up a new gas station nowadays. Right? It's like that. That was her she camel. And this she camel, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, they will be set free. In the beginning of the surah, it says they will be set free. So the Arab is thinking, man, my she camel? It's going to be set free. He's so worried about the she camel. But then there's another pregnancy and nobody cares. The other pregnancy is that of the girl that's born. Oh, that's humiliation for my family. Bury that one. SubhanAllah. Because that shows I'm not man enough to have a son. Right? This is what their jahiliyyah, their ignorance was. So there's one, the birth of an animal is more precious to this disgusting human being than this. What horrible injustice. Allah calls towards justice. In the surah, he exposes their injustice. Well, nobody would ask. Nobody would raise this issue. Allah raised this issue in the Quran. And Allah is not raising this issue at the hands of someone who have power and authority and police and weapons. He's raising it at the hands of a messenger, who, whoever he calls insane, who everybody spits at and goes away and persecutes his followers, والسلام, but the call for justice. See how the Quran like starts shaking society, calls people at that level, and then it goes at that level even above, which we started with. What were you created from? How horrible your disbelief? How obnoxious can you be? Now, I share all of this with you because the Quran, what stands today, our relationship with the Quran is one of either casual reading of English translation, right? Or maybe read some tafsir here and there. But what was the culture of the Quran and the Sahaba? What was the culture that was embedded in them? We learned that the Sahaba were constantly reciting the Quran. Constantly. In many narrations, we find they would finish the entire Mus'haf in a week, every week. A seventh of the Quran every day. That's about 4.5 juz of recitation nowadays. Every day. 4.25 at least. Every single day. They're reciting the Quran, reciting the Quran. You think if you recite for 30 years, 20 years, 10 years, the whole book once a week, every week, do you think you'd naturally just memorize it anyway? SubhanAllah. Right? This is just a natural way of becoming one with the Quran. And when you read it so much, and the Quran is talking about what things? Only things inside the book or outside the book too? It's talking about things outside the book. The Quran's ayat are called, of course, ayat. And the creation outside is also called ayat. And لَفِي خَلْقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ at the end of that ayat, the ayatin, these are ayat. And then even in the Quran, هُوَ آيَاتٌ بَيِّنَاتٌ فِي صُدُورِ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ. These ayat talk about those ayat. And those ayat remind you of these ayat. And that's all of that is happening inside the heart of a believer. We said the fitrah is compared with light, correct? We said the fitrah is compared with light. And when Allah talks about the Quran, He says, فَآمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَالنُّورِ الَّذِي أَنزَلْنَا. Believe in Allah and His Messenger and in what? In the light that we have sent down. What is the light that Allah has sent down? The Quran. So now the Quran comes into contact with us. We internalize this Quran. Our fitrah is what? Light. The Quran is what? Light. Now this light meets light. Allah calls that what? Nurun ala nur. Light coming into contact with light. This is what Allah describes as happening inside the heart of a believer. When they internalize the ayat of the Quran. They start seeing the world with these ayat. And they start seeing something that nobody else sees. Everybody sees grass. Everybody sees grass. It's not just me. And we were sitting on the lawn outside when you guys were planting the tree, right? We're sitting out there. We all see the grass, we all see the tree, we all see the dirt. But the believer, when he sees the grass, you know what he's reminded of? He's reminded of when Allah speaks of the earth sprouting life. He's reminded that Allah brings life out of death. Nobody else sees that. Who sees that? The believer. Because he has what inside him? The ayat. When he sees the rain, he's reminded, وَالسَّمَاءَ إِذَا تَرَّجَ عَيْبُلَانِ. I started with that. The sky that has the feature of returning, that tarraja, the feature of returning, possessing the power of returning. What does that mean, sky returning? We learn in tafsir, it means that the rain comes back over and over again. But why use the word return? Why not just use the word rain? Why? Because the water comes, then it dries up, and where does it go? It goes back up. And what happens again? It comes back down, it goes back up, it comes back down. وَالسَّمَاءِ إِذَا تَرَّجَ. And you look at the sky and you say, this return that goes on. And there's another return in the same surah. You know what that return is? The fluid, the man's fluid, the sperm, enters into the womb of the woman. So there's one going in. What comes out? A human being comes out. Fluid goes in, and what comes out? A human being. And Allah says, إِنَّهُ عَلَىٰ رَجْعِهِ لَقَادِرٌ. No doubt, He is capable. He has power over returning him. Meaning, just like He can take him in a fluid, bring him out a human being, He can put him into the grave and bring him out back to life again. All of this thought process starts where? When it starts raining. Just when it starts raining, the believers, you know, their thoughts go wild. Just the way you drive home now should change. Allah Azza wa Jalla does not let us escape the ayat of the Quran because He talks about things you see all the time. You know how much Allah talks about the sky? Constantly talks about the sky. You know, sometimes He talks about the destruction of the sky, sometimes He talks about the amazing power of the sky, right? Sometimes He talks about the sky being peeled and destroyed, right? It's peeled, it's open. All these different kinds of, and you can't escape it in the day, you can't escape it at night. And in the daytime, Allah says, وَالشَّمْسِ وَالْضُحَاهَا وَالْهَرْسِ. He makes you think about the sun. And when you think of the sun, he says, وَإِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوْوِيَرَتْ. إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوْوِيَرَتْ. When the, you know, when you look at the sun, your eyes squint, you can't really look at it. But Allah says, He'll wrap it up so you can look at it. It will be folded up. كُوْوِيَرَتْ. That day is coming too, when this sun will be easy to look at, and that will be a horrifying day. That in itself will be a horrifying day. So the way we perceive reality outside is completely morphed and transformed when we have a relationship with this Quran. This is part of what Allah means when He says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Why is it then, or do they not then, reflect deeply into the Quran? تَدَبَّر means, comes from the word دُبْر, literally. دُبْر means the back of something. Why don't they look into the Qur'an and look all the way into the back of its meanings, deep into its meanings? Why don't they dive in? Why don't they reflect? أَمَّا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِنَا أَقْفَالُهَا. Or is it the case that hearts have locks placed on them, meaning the heart is locked, the ayat tried to come in, and what happened? They didn't get access, there was no light of not light. It was locked up, there was no access. So it's beautiful wordings in the Qur'an. Now, the last thing I want to share with you, inshaAllah, I was writing some things down, when I was coming here, so I want to make sure I don't forget. I think there was something I did want to share with you at the end. Yeah, just about the Sana'i Dhat project. Actually, here's what I want to share with you. Imaniyat. You guys know the study of Aqidah, right? Forget all the technicalities. Forget all the technicalities. You want to talk about Islam or the thought process of a believer to a non-Muslim. Just understand the way, you want to explain it to a second grader, a first grader, you're not going to tell them the Ubiya or Ubiya as possible. You're not going to go down that road, because that doesn't make sense to a second grader. It doesn't make sense to a non-Muslim. They don't, this is not going to be something they can want. Most Muslims can't process that stuff. Forget non-Muslims. Basically, our faith boils down to three things. It boils down to three things. Divinity, the divine, right? So there's constantly, there are hints in the Quran that make you reflect and think about who? Allah Himself, His creative power, His wisdom, His mercy, His forgiveness, etc. The second thing is revelation. The second core concept is revelation. And revelation is a very difficult concept. What do I mean that it's a difficult concept? It's easy to believe in a God. That's not hard. But it's very difficult to believe that that guy over there, an angel came to him and gave him revelation, and now he speaks on behalf of God. Now, for us it's easy because there are millions of Muslims. But when the Messenger first comes and says the revelation has come to him, an angel comes to him, and somebody says, which angel? What are you talking about? I don't see any. No, you can't. It's from the unseen. You have to believe in the unseen. What's the most common response? You're crazy. Isn't that the response in the Quran? If somebody said that to you, what would you call them? I have revelation, an angel comes. Forget the fact that, imagine the 3,000 years ago, somebody came to you and said, an angel comes to me, and he gave me revelation, and since you're my neighbor, I feel my obligation to share with you first. You have to believe in what I'm saying, and you have to follow every word I say. Nothing I say is subject to question, because if you question me, it is the same as questioning God Himself. How believable is that? How easy is that for you to accept? You understand? Believing in divinity is easy. Believing in a messenger is difficult, for many reasons. One, because it takes a leap, a serious leap of faith, a bigger leap of faith than Allah. Because the belief in Allah is in the fitrah. The belief of Allah what? In the fitrah. But the belief in a messenger, it comes only to those who respected that fitrah. Only to them it comes easy, otherwise the skepticism comes. You know, I can believe in a God, I don't know about this messenger business. This guy gets revelation, I can't question anything he says. Everything is perfect, everything is divine. From him, subhanAllah. So this is the second core concept that Allah talks about in the Quran. We'll talk a little bit about the importance of it and then come to the third. The first one was what again? Divinity. The second one? Revelation. The idea of revelation, meaning it comes to a man and he delivers it. This idea itself is very difficult for people to accept. The third core concept is an afterlife. This isn't the only thing there is to life, there's something more. This is why you should be worried about revelation. Why should I care? Okay, there's a messenger. What's the big deal? What's the harm if I don't really concern myself with this? It's just casual information that doesn't affect my life. It's just another useless piece of information like the back of a Snapple cap. Right? Useless data. What's the difference? What difference does it make? It makes a difference because you, whether you like it or not, you're headed towards this place, you have an appointment, and you can't avoid it, and that appointment is coming inevitably after your death. Right? So the three things, divinity, revelation, and afterlife. And they're connected to each other. They're all logically connected to each other. But here I want to share with you something about how Allah defends the integrity of revelation. Those who believe. At the time of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, you know, when they heard Quran, they came up with different theories of what this Quran really is. One of the most predominant theories was it's magic. That's one of the most predominant theories of disbelief. Is this how Quran is? Magic. And they would call him Sahir. Okay? Inna hadha la sahir wa kadhdhab. Now, you know, by them calling it magic and calling the messenger a magician, they've already accepted that it's not something normal. They've accepted that it's something paranormal. It can't be explained through common sense. And the only thing we can say is, we're not willing to say he's a messenger, so the only thing else we can come up with is magic. That tells you in and of itself that the Quran mystified them. They couldn't justify that a human being can come up with this through common sense. This is something magical. So magic is kind of between, you know, disbelief and belief. It's the state in between. So they've already taken a leap by calling it magic. They called him Sahib, they called him a magician, and they called him Kaddab. They didn't call him Kathim, they called him Kaddab. This is Mubarak, Sayyidul Mubarak. What this means is, he's a relentless liar. He's a magician, and he's a relentless liar. Now why would they call him, and by the way, this seems like an insult to the Messenger of Allah, even this is a compliment. Because when they say relentless, what does that mean? What does the Messenger do? He's constantly making doubt. He doesn't stop. When you call somebody a liar, you'll go to somebody else and talk to them, because every time you talk to them, what do they call you? A liar. Does that stop the Messenger? No. What does that teach you about da'wah? Da'wah is you're talking to somebody about Islam, he gets a little heated. And he starts insulting you. Right? You say, forget you, I'll find a better customer. Right? Does the Messenger have better customers? He's always dealing with the same exact people for a decade. Can you imagine? And on top of that, he's dealing with family. Have you dealt with family? How easy is it to talk to your cousin about his son? Or your uncle? Hey, uncle, let me tell you something about Akhmed. Oh, you're going to tell me about Akhmed? Let me tell you about your, you know. Right? That's what happens in family. Who is he talking to for 10 years? His family, his neighbor. Can you imagine how tough that is? So, when they called him Sahir and Kaddab, these were actually compliments. One, to the mystifying power of the Qur'an, and two, to the relentless commitment of the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. So that's one, magician. Another thing they called him was that he said that he gets his information from jinns. There are two ways of saying it. One is, they call him Majnun. Majnun means is the jinn possesses him, also means that, you know, janna alayhi aqlahu. What it means is that his intellect has been covered up. Because jinn comes from the word janin, which is the room which is covered. Jannah, garden, which is covered up with greenery, and the dirt is covered. So jinn, that which is covered from our eyes, right? So his intellect is covered. So he's gone crazy, basically, right? But there's so that a jinn comes and tells him, shayateen come and tell him. And this was part of their culture. You know, even nowadays in like downtown Manhattan or midtown Manhattan, these corporate executives, when they go make a multi-million-dollar deal, they go see the psychic reader first. Like you can go on Park Avenue, 55th Street, Midtown. These huge multi-million-dollar buildings, and on the first floor there's a psychic reader. How is he affording rent over there? You know what happens? All these executives, they say, what color tie should I wear to the meeting? Seriously. Should I wear my lucky pin here or there? And then the psychic reader does whatever and tells them, yeah, wear this one. That'll be $500, that'll be $2,000, whatever. This was going on back in the day. This is not something new. This was going on back in the day. The Arab would come and say, should we attack that tribe? Should we kill all of them? And the guy was saying, hold on, let me tell you. And yeah, you should go. The Shayateen came and told me, because they came from the stars, they gave me the information, you should kill all of them. Or you should marry that woman. Or you should divorce her. Or whatever else. So they would come to the Kahin, the mind reader, and the one, the soothsayer. They would say that we get our information from where? The stars. So the Arabs, the mythology was, the stars, the devils go there, get information, and come back and tell these soothsayers. And this is what Muhammad is doing to Ma'adullah, that what he has to say is just like what these soothsayers have to say. He's just getting information from the devils, that's all it is. Now Allah has told you swears that we heard in Salah. فَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِي مَوَاقِعِ النُّجُومِ I swear by the placement of the stars. Who placed the stars there? Who knows better about the stars? The one who's sitting in the desert looking at the stars, or the one who placed them there? So he says, those stars themselves are witness that this is the Quran. This is the noble Quran that comes from Kitab al-Maqnun in a hidden book. That's where it comes from. And just to tell you how Allah gives dignity to His revelation, how Allah protects His revelation, the way He speaks about it is so amazing. Just to give you some parallels, so you appreciate how Allah gives, you know, those who believed along the Messenger of Islam, how they understood that this word is something profound. You know, on the one hand, you have the Messenger talking to the leaders of Quraysh, who are arrogant. And when you talk to someone, like, you know, a guy is trying to buy a car, and all these salespeople in the parking lot, in the dealership, they all kind of hound around him. Can I help you? Can I help you? Can I help you? Right? They're trying to sell him something. Sometimes it feels like that guy is trying to sell someone something. Right? And when you try to sell someone something, we're trying to convince someone of something, then who's got the upper hand? The seller or the customer? The customer's got the upper hand. So when the messenger would give da'wah to the leaders of Quraysh, what did the Quraysh leaders feel? They felt they had the upper hand. Yeah, sounds interesting, but you got this blind guy over here, you got these other people here, get rid of them, and maybe we'll listen. They felt like they were in a position to negotiate, right? They were in a position to, you know, give back and forth, work with me a little. But do a little for you, this is what Allah says Himself. They really want that you give and take a little. Barter with them, trade with them. When Allah spoke about this matter, He said, no, this is not something for negotiation, this is not something alone. كَلَّا إِنَّهَا تَذْكِرَةً فَمَنْ شَاءَ ذَكَرَةً فِي صُحُفٍ مُكَرَّمَةً مَرْفُوعَةٍ مُطَهَّرَةً بِأَيْدِي سَفَرَةً كِرَامٍ بَرَرَةً This word is way up there in the possession of the most noble of the angels. It's very elevated. You should be honored that you got a chance to hear this word. Instead of you coming here and negotiating, you should know how high this word is. There's no room for negotiation. I don't need to sell it to you. You need it. This word doesn't need you. It's too high above. It's far above from you. So the surah Allah illustrates how high the revelation is and how the low the people are. So don't ever think that we're going to need to sell. Right? This revelation is too high. Whoever comes to it has only benefited himself, and whoever doesn't has lost on a huge treasure. They were actually honored by even having heard the Quran, because it comes from such a high place. And only the closest to Allah are in company of it. Right? So now this is the place of revelation. But it doesn't just stay there, it comes down, doesn't it? It comes down. Who brings it down? Jibreel alayhi salam. So then we find in the Quran, you know, إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلُ رَسُولٍ كَرِيمٍ بِقُوَّةٍ. You know, when you deliver a classified document, like a high value document, like the government wants to send something from DC to, let's say, Seattle, Washington, how would they send it? FedEx or regular mail? How would they send a high classified document? What do you think they would do? No, it wouldn't be registered. You know, classified document would be like a, you know, like the armored vehicle and security details, and only high-level clearance people will travel with it, or a private plane will go, or something like that, right? There's some special arrangements are made when classified documents are delivered. And the people delivering them have to be high clearance. They just can't be just some guy, security guy, or delivery guy, because it's too valuable of information. So first of all, tells us Jibreel is the one. Who's classification? What's his security clearance level? عِنْدَ بِالْعَرْشِ مَكِينٌ Allah tells us, right under the arsh, security clearance is, he's stationed over here. That's his place. And the one delivering it has to be strong enough, so if somebody tries to attack and steal this information, they should be able to defend it. So he says, ذِي قُوَّةٍ He's strong. Who's going to mess with Jibreel alayhi salam? Look at his strength. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bin ufuqin mubin. He saw him across the entire horizon, taking over the entire horizon. This is what the messenger saw, Jibreel alayhi salam. So he's the one delivering it, and now that he's delivering it, he's got an entire detail, security detail with a qa'im, a follower, he's followed. In other words, he doesn't just deliver it alone, an entire entourage of security comes. This is the way in which revelation comes down to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is not something small. So it comes to him, subhanAllah, in this way. So Allah protects the way we should think about revelation. How Allah delivered this revelation in the realm of the unseen. You know, nowadays we have a discussion, how was the Quran preserved? Right? These parchments and these things and this surah and that, this or that, yeah. You know, the one who believes, what do they know about this revelation? These things are laughable. What are you talking about? What are you talking about? Do you know how this revelation came? So how Allah protected it? You know, so it gives the believer a sense of conviction above anything else. And when you hear these lowly discussions, they don't affect you. But when you're not connected to the Qur'an, what happens when you hear these things? You know what happens to the youth around you that take a philosophy course or two, or Islamic studies, or Islamic studies 101, or Middle Eastern studies? What happens to them after one course? They get messed up in the head. Why? There's no connection to the Qur'an. We're not connected with this book. We're not, you know, entangled in this thought. It's where we haven't become one with it. And this is something that was the legacy of our companions, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. Umar ibn al-Khattab used to go around and check with everyone. Al-Halaqat of the Masajid, Al-Halaqat of Qur'an going on in every masjid. This was the culture of the Sahaba. It's absolutely critical. So where do you guys begin, practically speaking? Where do you begin? Where do you begin to develop this strong relationship with the Qur'an? Begin with the surah. You look at the entire letter and say, okay, forget it, I'm going to remember it. This is too much. Begin with the surah. Memorize the surah. Study the surah. Listen to a dars on the surah. Get the imam to give you a tafsir class on that surah. Right? Then recite that surah in the salah. Then think deeply about that surah. Then find, look outside and see what did Allah talk about in that surah that you see outside. For example, you memorize something so small like Surah Al-Asr. Every time you look at that clock back there, what do you say to yourself? Well, Asr is in the sun of the people. It changes the way you look at a clock. Every time you see Asr time come in, what do you say to yourself? Well, Asr. In the sun of the people. Every time the professor says you only have 3 weeks left in the semester to be over, you say, oh, seriously. Now what happens is the surah has become part of your life. It's become part of your thinking. You've embedded it into your life. Then you move on to what? The next surah. The next surah. The next ayah. And every time you come into these contact with the outside world, it brings you back to the Quran. There's this back and forth with the Quran. Right? This is what we have to develop. And really, when you don't have this, there's a spiritual void. You don't have a serious connection with the Qur'an, your salah is empty. You don't feel anything in salah when you hear the words. And when you don't feel anything, your heart feels, the light is there, but it hasn't met the other light, right? So what does the heart try to do? It tries to find other things to fill that void. So when you say you feel an itch if you haven't gone to see that movie in the theater, or if you haven't gone to play pool with your buddies, or, you know, play that app for hours and hours on your iPhone or something, you fill that void with something, because your heart will feel that void. But nothing will fill that void like what? Like the remembrance of Allah, and the ultimate remembrance of Allah is Qur'an itself. In huwa illa dhikrun wa Qur'an mubin. This is nothing but a reminder. Kalla inna atadhkira. This is nothing but a powerful means of delivering a reminder. Wa dhakkir bil Qur'an. Remind with the Qur'an. Reminder, reminder, reminder. Allah keeps saying reminder. It's such an awesome reminder. Last thing I'll say, and we break inshallah. Last thing I'll say, you know, usually when somebody reminds you of something, usually, when they remind you of something, it's one of two things. Remind you of something in the past, or remind you of something in the future that you forgot about that you have to worry about. Hey, do you remember the finals next week? Right? Or did you forget what happened in that time you got caught cheating? Right? You're getting reminded either by the past or by the future. What does the Quran do? It reminds you of the people of the past. Then it reminds you of what's going to happen to you and me where? In the future. It takes us to the future and tells us this. Remember this. Imprint it in your mind. And then Allah will be saying this, this, and this. Imprint it in your mind. Allah will be saying to the believers, Kulu wa shrabu hani'an bima kuntum da'malu. Eat and drink freely. Live it up because of the good things you used to do. Enjoy yourselves. Party. Allah is commanding the believers that eat it up. Eat up and enjoy. Hani'an, carefree. Remember that day. Remember that. Remember. Don't forget to work for that day when I say that to you. See how Allah, I'm really reminds, what a powerful reminder. And so, in this last 2 minutes, wrapping up this comment, where does a believer develop a relationship with the Qur'an? Where? Two places. They're really the same. The prayer, number one, on a daily basis, the prayer, is where, what's the longest part of the salah? Right? This is the divine installation. This is taught by the Messenger himself, the longest part of the salah is standing. And what are we doing when we're standing? We're saying Qur'an. We're standing there and we're saying Qur'an. So we're listening to Qur'an. That's what we're doing. This is really where our reform takes place. Our relationship with Qur'an is revived in the salah itself. You don't even have to have an outside program and pass out flyers or event. The event is already in there designed by Allah. And then there's a convention every week. There's the weekly event, then there's the convention at the end. What is that convention? The Friday prayer and the Friday the khutbah. If you look at the khutbah, the khutbahs of the Messenger, they were just ayat of Quran. There was nothing else. He would begin with the hamd of Allah, the salawat upon the Messenger, and he would recite the ayat of Quran, aqim salat. The khutbah itself was what? Quran, multiple khutbahs of the Messenger of Islam. Just entirely ayat of the Quran. So what is the khutbah supposed to be? A reminder from the Quran. And from a practical point of view, a reminder that people can memorize. So do a reminder from this khutbah, because most people memorize. Or do a reminder from two ayat of Quran and pass it out to the community and say, memorize these ayat and use them in salah this whole week. And next week we'll do two other ayat and remind people. A practical reminder. Bring Quran into your life. And the means of it, salah, and of course the Jama'ah prayer, come to Jama'ah early, take precautions of it, come well-dressed, take it like a serious event, like people get dressed for graduation, and people get dressed, for a job interview. Get dressed, you're meeting with Allah, man. Get dressed. Come early and listen intently. Even if the khutbah is boring, don't worry about it. Don't worry, don't say it's not entertaining, that's why I come late. Don't do that to yourself. You're coming for the sake of Allah. May Allah Azza wa Jalla give us the ability to think and to understand the world around us by means of His ayat. May Allah give us a true love of the work of Allah and the sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah give us a correct understanding of His book and a correct understanding of the Sunnah of His Messenger. And may Allah grant all of us, our children, our families, real khushu, real attentiveness and humility, and overwhelmed awe of Allah in every single one of our salawat. And may He grant us genuine tears of fear of Him in our salawat. Barakallahu wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim. Wa nafa'ali wa liya'um bil ayat al-Hakim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.